Good morning, church. We're continuing to worship at home this week as we make preparations to relocate out to our Platte Ridge property. Our construction crew is hard at work putting some finishing touches on the new place. But in the meantime, we wanted to open up the building on Sunday, December 6th. You're welcome to come for a walkthrough anytime between 8 a.m. and 2 p.m. But we are asking that you wear a mask and you practice social distancing. The following weekend, we'll be opening up the building so that we can saturate our new space in prayer and scripture reading. Beginning Thursday at 5 p.m., we'll start in Genesis with a goal of continuing all the way through scripture until the end of Revelation. There's a couple of ways that you can be involved in that weekend. The first is to bring up your family and just spend some time praying in our sanctuary. Pray about the worship that will happen there, the ministry that we'll have with our community, and the lives that will be changed. And the other way that you can be involved is to sign up for a 15-minute time slot to read scripture aloud in our sanctuary as people pray. You can sign up to read scripture and find additional details on our website. We're finishing up this week on our sermon series called Grateful. One of the things that we're going to be reading in scripture is how Jesus is the light of the world. And it's a reminder to us of our call to be a light in our community. Sometimes whenever we're worshiping at home, it's so easy to forget that the power of the church comes from the things that we do collectively. And one of those things is the way that we give to the same purpose. And so we want to remind you to continue to give faithfully as we enter this new era of ministry and we pray about all the things that God will do. Rusty's wrapping up our sermon series today, continuing the story of Nehemiah in chapter 8, where it talks about the celebration of the Feast of Tabernacles. The scripture that we'll be reading today is from John. In John chapter 7, it says, "On the last day, the climax of the festival, Jesus stood and shouted to the crowds, 'Anyone who is thirsty may come to me. Anyone who believes in me may come and drink. For the scriptures declare, rivers of living water will flow from his heart.'" And in chapter 8, it continues and says, "Jesus spoke to the people once more and said, 'I am the light of the world. If you follow me, you won't have to walk in darkness because you will have the light that leads to life.'" Will you pray with me? God, help us to be your light in our community, that in the same way that you led people to life, that we can be a part of the work that you're doing and the people around us, so that the words that we speak life instead of death, so that the things that we do bring new life to people who are struggling. In all the ways that we can be a reflection of you, we're asking you to help us carry out those tasks so that the people in our community can see the hope that you have for their life. I sing, oh,
Hey everybody, I hope you had a tremendous Thanksgiving. I hope you were able to get with some people that you loved and you cared about. I hope you were able, if you weren't able even to be in person, to talk with them. I want to pray for those of you who maybe had a challenging time because of maybe some losses that you've experienced over this year. In fact, I want to pray that over you right now. Father, in Jesus' name, I know the great joys linger, but Lord, so do the great sorrows. And Father, I pray in Jesus' name that you would, by your presence, bring healing to us as we worship you. In Jesus' name, amen. So we've been talking about grateful. How do we live lives grateful, aware of the presence of God and the hand of God and the provision of God in our lives? And we've been using Nehemiah for an example. And today, at the end of our time together, we're going to share the Lord's Supper. And you may see these elements on the table in front of me and think, that doesn't look exactly right, Rusty. Now, I'll get to that in a minute, but let me just share a verse with you from Nehemiah where on the completion of Nehemiah's work, when the wall had been built and the city had been stabilized, it had been secured, everything was in its place, the people came together to celebrate that. And they celebrated around the Word of God, and they celebrated around the teaching of the Word of God. And it says this, Nehemiah says to the people, he says, "Go and enjoy choice food and sweet drinks, and send some to those who have nothing prepared. This day is holy to our Lord, so don't grieve, for the joy of the Lord is your strength." I want us to have the Lord's Supper today kind of informed around that experience of being overwhelmed with gratitude, but also overcome with the weight of knowing that I live in the presence of God. So we're going to enjoy some choice food and some sweet drink, and together we're going to celebrate what Jesus has done for us. But to introduce that, I want to just offer you something. It's not questions like we usually have, but I've been thinking a lot about what I'm calling in my mind the gratitude cycle. We're talking about how to live lives grateful. And I've been thinking about this gratitude cycle. I want to introduce it to you so that when we see it in the scripture, you can recognize it. So gratitude, that sense of being loved and welcomed and treasured by God. Gratitude, when you really are in the moment with gratitude, it can make you feel really, really big, that somehow God knows you and he knows what you need and he knows where you are and he knows how to meet you there. It makes you feel really big, really important. And it leads you to worship, right? Gratitude leads to worship. And worship, if you stay there long enough, if you soak in it long enough, if you let the music and the words and the thoughts, if you let it sink all the way down into your heart, it can make you feel really, really small. Because worship, by definition, makes much of God. And when you make much of God, you realize, who am I that I get to worship the King? Who am I that I get to worship the Creator of all? Who am I that God would know me? Gratitude can make you feel really, really big. Worship, if you stay there long enough, can bring you to the place where you feel really, really small, which can lead you beautifully, I might add, lead you to repentance. Gratitude, worship, repentance. Repentance can make you feel really, really committed to say, "Oh God, you whom I have worshiped, you on whose name I have called, oh Father, who am I that you would know me? But Lord, having tasted and seen that you are God, having worshiped and come into your presence, Lord, I don't want to live without that. So whatever in me that does not belong, God, in Jesus' name, I surrender it to you. I agree with you. I admit to you. I am a sinner and I need a Savior, and Jesus, come to me." It leads you. Gratitude leads to worship, which leads to repentance. And repentance, precious ones, repentance leads to a renewal and an obedience that says, "I want to do whatever it takes to be welcomed back into that relationship with God," which leads you back to gratitude. You ready to walk this circle with me? So I want to give you some things in the book of Nehemiah that lead us to this. The wall around Jerusalem has been built. We have these report cards along the way. At one point, the report card says the whole wall had been built back to half its height. Well, that's good, but it's not enough. And then there's another place where Nehemiah says, so the wall had been built to all of its height, and there was not a break left in it, although the gates and the doors had not been reset yet. So it was still vulnerable. So that's good. That's very good. It's three quarters of the way done, but it's not enough yet. And then it says this in Nehemiah chapter 6, verse 15, it says, so the wall was completed on the 25th day of Elul in 52 days. Now, if you happen to read the New Living Translation, you'll see that they actually set a date on that fits our paradigm. It says on October 2nd, 445 BC, the wall was finished, 52 days. And the thing I want to call your attention to there, because we're coming up on it in our big project, we're coming up on a day that will be the day that they will hand us the keys. We're coming up on a day where they will say, it is done, it is yours. And we'll be able to look and identify it was on this day in this year, the project was completed, it was done. Nehemiah says, it was on October 2nd, 445, it was 52 days and the project was done, it was completed. It says this, it says, when all our enemies heard about this and all the surrounding nations, they were afraid and they lost their self-confidence because they realized that this work had been done with the help of our God. Man, I love that. Because all the people around us now, all our neighbors, all our friends, all the people who've been watching that building go up on 371, the people who ask us all the time, so when is it going to be done? When are you going to have your first service there? And what's that going to look like? There's going to come a time when they're going to look and they're going to say, wow, this has all been done with the help of their God. God is the one who called. God is the one who provided. Oh, it's going to be good. It's going to be so good. Then there's a place just a little while later when it talks about after the wall had been rebuilt. This is Nehemiah chapter 7, verse 1. After the wall had been rebuilt and the doors set in place, the gatekeepers, the musicians, the Levites, they were all appointed. In other words, we started to lay a groundwork for worship. We started to consecrate the place by worshiping God and calling on the name of the Lord. There's this song that we used to sing all the time, and we still do sometimes. This is holy ground. This is holy ground, right? Where we worship is sanctified by God's presence because He inhabits our praises. And Nehemiah says, once it was done, we just started to carpet bomb the place with worship. We just started to bring the musicians and the gatekeepers and the Levites. And just a few days after that sort of dedication service, the day the wall was finished, it says this, chapter 8 of Nehemiah. When the seventh month came and the Israelites had settled in their towns, all the people came together as one in the square before the water gate, and they told Ezra, the teacher of the law, to bring out the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord commanded for Israel. And so on the first day of the seventh month, Ezra the priest brought the law before the assembly, which was made up of men and women and all who were able to understand. And he read it aloud from daybreak until noon, just opened the Word of God and began to just pour it out. Just opened the Word of God and the people began to just soak in it. We're going to do something like that, actually. Be watching for all the details, because in just a couple of weeks, we're going to take some time before a grand opening, before some kind of a dedication service. We're going to take some time, and you're invited to participate. We're going to read the Word of God from Genesis all the way to Revelation. We're just going to open it, and you're invited. You can sign up. Be watching for details. You can sign up to say, I want to read a 15-minute segment, and it's going to be around the clock through the wee hours of the morning. You can sign up and just read the Word of God and then pass it off to the next person and the next person and the next person. 300 names will be needed Oh, I can see families coming together and saying, the wife, the husband, the children who are old enough to read, each taking a turn. And as a family being part of this consecration of our new church home, just pouring out the Word of God on it. You should sign up. You should be a part of that. I can even picture people deciding to just come and just sit and just take it in. Just let the Word of God wash over you. It's going to be a time of worship, a time of consecration. Anyway, I love this. I had to call my grandson Ezra and tell him this because it says in chapter 8, verse 5, it says, Ezra opened the book and all the people could see him. And Ezra, verse 6, praised the Lord, the great God. And all the people lifted their hands and they responded, Amen, Amen. And they bowed down and they worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground. There's just this sense of the gratitude for the task finished, right? That leads to a worship that just says, God, you are God. You are the one who called us. You are the one who provided for us. There's this beautiful picture. But it's interesting because as it goes on, it says this. It says the people who were standing there hearing the Word of God being read, hearing it made clear and explained and given meaning. It says, Nehemiah the governor and Ezra the priest and the teacher of the law and the Levites who were instructing the people, they said to them, this day is holy to the Lord your God, so don't mourn or weep. Remember that gratitude cycle, right? Gratitude that leads to worship. The gratitude that makes you feel really, really big. God has done something in us and with us and through us. It makes us feel really important, right? In the will of God. But then you worship, and the more you make much of God, the more you realize that, man, in the grand scheme of things, God is so big and I'm so little. And it says the people, they began to weep and to mourn, not because by comparison, right, my life, I've not lived in such a way that I would be worthy to worship the King. So the gratitude that leads to worship, the worship that ultimately, as God is made big, I am put in my place. And I begin to say, Lord, in Jesus' name, who am I that I get to worship you? Yeah? And they said this. They said, don't mourn or weep. For the people had been weeping as they had listened to the words of the law. Nehemiah said, go and enjoy choice food and sweet drinks. Thus, our Lord's Supper that we're going to share in a minute. And I'm going to tell you why it's with this crazy almond croissant that I love that I'm going to lead you in the Lord's Supper in a little bit. But it says, all the people went away to eat and to drink and send portions of food and to celebrate with great joy. Because now they understood the words that have been made known to them. And it put me in mind of Thanksgiving. It did. It put me in mind of the times when we say, you know what? We're going to celebrate with the things that make us feel good. We're going to celebrate with the things that make us feel special. And we're going to share with the people we love the most. And it's a beautiful thing. And on the heels of that, the people realized, having read the Word of God, there were some ways they hadn't measured up, and they immediately went into what the Old Testament calls the Feast of Tabernacles, a time when people would bring boughs from the trees and limbs and branches, and they would build these temporary shelters, maybe on the roof of their house or in the courtyard of their home, and they would live in these temporary dwellings, these little tabernacles, because they wanted to be reminded and they wanted to stay fresh and clear that God is the one who has carried us through all this journey up until now. God is the one who has brought us from where we were, Lord help us, to where we are now. Lord, thank you, right? And so for 7 days, they lived in these tabernacles, these booths, and then they heard the Word of God, and they listened to the Word of God, and they made themselves ready for what was coming next, even though they didn't know what was coming next. And even as I say this thing, it just sounds like where we are as a people, right? We want to make our hearts ready for what's coming next, even though we don't know exactly what's coming next, but we know that the Word of God stands forever and that the God who called us has brought us and He'll carry us. And so there's this thing there's this thing in Scripture, it's called a holy history. A holy history. It comes when people want to recount all the ways that God has been faithful. When Stephen was stoned in the book of Acts, he just started, he started with creation. He just unfolded all the ways that God had been faithful. In the Psalms, when you read the Psalms, David will recount, Lord, you brought us into this place and you led us out before our enemies. And they just recount this holy history to remind you how faithful God is. Well, in Nehemiah chapter 9, there's this holy history that sets up. Stand up and praise the Lord God who is from everlasting to everlasting. Blessed be your glorious name and may it be exalted above all blessing and praise. You alone are the Lord. You made the heavens, even the highest heavens and all their starry hosts. And it just recounts all the things that God has done, but it begins to remember the ways that we and our ancestors have become arrogant and stiff-necked and did not obey your commands and refused to listen and failed to remember. And it just leads ultimately, you know, as you make much of God, it leads ultimately to a moment of repentance and surrender in your own heart, which brings you to a moment, and this comes over and over again in Scripture, and it comes over and over again in my life, and I want to invite you into it in your life. A moment that the theologian would call covenant renewal. It says this in Nehemiah chapter 9, verse 38. It says, in view of all this, we are making a binding agreement. We are putting it in writing, and our leaders, our Levites, and our priests are affixing their seals to it. We want to come down to a moment when we say, Lord, in Jesus' name, we give you our all. In fact, as we begin to meet in our new home and gather and consecrate, there may be some people who want to take that time and say, you know what? I want to come and I want to come and give an offering here at the end of the year. I want to catch up on some things that I've missed. I want to go all in. This coming Tuesday, Giving Tuesday, they call it. But it's a time for us to come together and say, you know what? I want to go all in. I want to put my shoulder to the wheel. I want to go forward with this. I want to renew my agreement with the Lord, the gratitude that leads to worship, that leads to confession, that leads to renewal. God, I want in on that. Sign me up. Count me in. And that's where the Lord's Supper comes in. When we have Lord's Supper together, and you remember how this goes, right? The bread that reminds us of the body of Christ broken for us. The bread where Jesus tells Paul on the night he was betrayed, he took bread and when he had given thanks, he broke it. He said, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Well, I want to do this with this beautiful, sweet comfort food, this choice food, just recognizing that, Lord, what you have done for us, for me, is so much more than I could have asked or imagined. And it's sweet, Lord, what you have done for me. It is rich, it is choice, it is beyond description. What you have done for me, Lord, and the price that you've paid for me. And so when we come to the Lord's Supper, I mean, we talk about it. We talk about it in 1 Corinthians 11, how the Lord wants us to bear the weight of it. But I think also it's not inappropriate, precious ones, to the weight of glory in it. And so you may have something left over from Thanksgiving, some King's Hawaiian bread or something choice and sweet and good. You could grab that right now even. And just remember that the painful, burdensome task that Jesus bore of a body broken led to us this incredible sweetness and joy and a deep desire to having taste and seen that he is good and want more of him. So So I want to invite you into this. If you may want to even pause the video and get your preparations. But to take the bread with a heart that would say, Lord, I'm so, so grateful for what you've done. In fact, it defies words, what you've done for me. And oh Lord Jesus, I'm grateful and I worship. And in the midst of that worship, I want to taste and see, right? The body broken. I want to taste and see how good you are. Just take a piece of that. And because this is just us, you could take and you could just bite it, right? And chew it and linger over it and savor it. And I'm going to do that right now. With a heart that would say, you are good. Oh, you are good, Lord. And Father, I've not been as good as I know I want to be. And then there's the cup. And I've always had this thought, maybe you've had it too, when we have the Lord's Supper together. And it's the grape juice, and it's very, very sweet, you know. But there's this line from the book of Revelation, I don't know if you remember it, where the angel says to John, he says, take the scroll and eat it, and in your mouth it will be sweet like honey, but in your belly it will be bitter. I don't know if you've ever had that time when we take the Lord's Supper together, when it's so sweet in your mouth, it's sweet on your tongue, but then as soon as you swallow, there's this sourness that comes. And I think that's intentional, because I think it's a reminder to say, what is so sweet to me came at a price. In 1 Corinthians 11, it says, in the same way, after supper, Jesus took the cup and he said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Covenant renewal, right? It's the new covenant in my blood. It's a reminder of what I've done for you that you couldn't do for yourself. And when you take this, you take it with a heart that says, Lord Jesus, it is by your blood and your sacrifice that I am yours. And oh, I'm grateful. And oh, Lord, it leads me to repentance. And it says in the Word of God that it is the shedding of blood that brings remission of sins. It is because our hearts have been sprinkled with the blood of Jesus that we can go boldly before His throne of grace. And because of that, precious ones, I lead you in that now. The new covenant in my blood, the covenant renewal. Lord, I will lay down whatever I need to lay down in order to take up this cup of the covenant. Do this in remembrance of me. Well, I want to invite you into that cycle of gratitude. Man, can you just stop and think and remember the incredible ways that God has been good to you? Can you do that? Can you hold on to that? I know these months have been hard, and a lot of people are really struggling to find joy and gratitude. But let me invite you to just stop and search and dig deep and ask the Lord, Lord, in Jesus' name, would you give me eyes to see where you've been at work in my life? Would you give me eyes to see, even though there are things that I regret, even though there are things that I wish or I long for, would you give me eyes to see and receive the goodness of God into my heart and my life? And then would you just begin to worship? Would you just begin to make much of God? To set God squarely and securely on the throne of the universe, let alone of your heart? God, you are God, I am not. God, you are the one who has provided. God, you have done for me what I couldn't ask or imagine, and then let God take you to a place of repentance that would cause your heart to say, God, I'm sorry. I'm sorry for all the things that I've reached out for instead of you. I'm sorry for all the things I've tried to hold on to instead of you. And Lord, you've brought me to the end of myself. And so, Father, I confess, I repent. I come to you and you alone. And then allow yourself that covenant renewal that says, Lord, I come to you now. I come to you now as best I know how, with all my heart and with all my soul and with all my strength. And I say, Lord, have me. I'm yours. And see if that circle won't take you all the way back to a heart of gratitude. Precious ones, these next few weeks hold so many powerful moments for us as a body of Christ. When we walk through the doors the first time to see this place that God has provided for us, that we've worked hard for, but it's God who's provided. That's a significant moment for you to take your kids and show them, this is what God has done. This is how God has led us. And then to take that time and open the Word of God together and speak it out over one another and to soak it in from one another. Oh, that's going to be a significant time over these next few weeks. And then to come to the place finally where we are able to say to our neighbors and to our families, to say, come. Jesus said this when he attended the Feast of the Tabernacles in John chapter 7. On the last and greatest day of the feast, Jesus stood and he said in a loud voice, if anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. And whoever believes in me, as the scripture has said, rivers of living water will flow from within him. Oh, precious ones, we are coming up on a moment of fulfillment, but it's also a moment of transition into what God will do with us going forward. I can't wait to see what God's going to do. And I love being your pastor. I love you guys. See ya.